Please stand for the reading of God's holy word. And our scripture reading this morning comes from Mark chapter 3. And I will be reading verses 13 through 19 from the New King James Version. If everyone is there, would you please say amen?
Amen.
And he went up on the mountain, and he called to him those he himself wanted. Imagine Jesus calling those to himself that he wanted. And they came to him. Then he appointed 12 that they might be with him and that he might send them out to preach and to have power to heal sicknesses and to cast out demons. Simon, to whom he gave the name Peter, James, the son of Zebedee, and John, the brother of James, to whom he gave the names Boanerges, that is, sons of thunder, Andrew, Philip, Bartholomew, Matthew, Thomas, James, the son of Alphaeus, Thaddeus, Simon the Canaanite, and Judas Iscariot, who also betrayed him, and they went into a house. So then faith cometh by hearing,
and hearing by the word of God.
You may be seated. My subject for this morning is calling choice men.
Amen.
Jesus doesn't just call anyone. Mm. Jesus calls choice men. Amen. Jesus calls men with hearts that are ripe and ready to be melted and molded. But not only that, he calls and appoints them. He anoints them and then he changes them.
Amen.
This is what this passage is all about. Jesus's impact on the 12 disciples, Jesus's impact on choice men. Verse 13 says, and he went up on the mountain and called to him those he himself wanted, and they came to him. The disciples were men called by Jesus.
Amen.
But I want you to notice three facts about what happened. Jesus called, picked out, and chose some choice men. Jesus called to him those he himself wanted, and the disciples came to him. Many men followed Jesus, but there were only a few, just a few, who showed more interest and more commitment than others.
Amen.
And Jesus noticed the ones who listened more attentively. He noticed those who were more awake and alert. He noticed those who responded with a stirred heart, those who showed more of an attachment to him after the crowds were gone. And he noticed those who wanted to serve God with meaning and purpose. And as we can very well see, Jesus isn't like us.
Amen.
Jesus didn't look at their stature or their physiques. He didn't look at their appearance or their looks. Jesus didn't even look at their ability and education. Jesus looked at their hearts.
Amen.
And when he saw a person listening, when he saw that a person was stirred and attached to him, when he saw that a person wanted to serve him, that's the person Jesus called. Jesus called to himself those he wanted for himself. And Jesus's will was the act of power. They didn't choose Jesus. Jesus chose them. John chapter 15, verse 16 says, you did not choose me, but I chose you and appointed you that you should go and bear fruit and that your fruit should remain, that whatever you ask the Father in my name, he may give you.
Amen.
Jesus didn't call those that the world thought were more fit and educated. Jesus called those whose hearts were right and responsive.
Mm-hmm.
Jesus knew the heart, and his call was based on the principle of heart response. How did their heart respond to Jesus? And the disciples' heart responded to Jesus because they came to him. Mm-hmm. And in the Greek, came means they went away to him. The idea is that they left, they forsook, they went away from their former work and undertook the new work assigned to them by Jesus.
Amen.
Luke chapter 18, verses 29 through 30 says, "So he said to them, 'Assuredly I say to you, there is no one who has left house or parents or brothers or wife or children for the sake of the kingdom of God who shall not receive many times more in this present time and in the age to come eternal life.'" Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Very simply, Jesus went up on a mountain and he called out the ones he wanted to go with him, and they came to him. Verses 14 through 15 says, "Then he appointed 12 that they might be with him, and that he might send them out to preach and to have power to heal sicknesses and to cast out demons." Appointed means to be made or ordained, which means to do, to make, to appoint with credentials. And appointed is often used to refer to a person that's being ordained or appointed to some high position or office. The picture is that of Jesus Christ, mm-hmm. the Son of God,
yeah.
the future King of the universe, taking 12 men
mm-hmm.
and appointing them to be his. And Jesus appoints. He ordains people to the office of being his ministers and representatives on earth. And the disciples were men appointed by Jesus for four specific purposes: to be with Jesus, to be sent forth, to preach, and to receive power. The disciples were appointed.
Yes.
This was the first lesson Jesus wanted to teach people, that before all else, God wants your personal fellowship and devotion.
Yes.
God wills above all else for us to know him,
mm-hmm.
to believe him,
yes.
and to understand him. Isaiah 43:10 says, "You are my witnesses, says the Lord, and my servant whom I have chosen, that you may know and believe me and understand that I am he. Before me there was no God formed, nor shall there be after me." The disciples were to live in the presence of Jesus, always learning of him and drawing their spiritual nourishment and strength from him. The disciples were appointed to be sent forth. They were apostles, and an apostle is sent out. He's a representative, an ambassador who's sent out into one country to represent another country. And the apostle belongs to the one who sent him out. He's commissioned to be sent out, and he possesses all the authority and power of the one who sends him out.
Amen.
And an apostle is a person chosen directly by the Lord himself,
yes.
or by the Holy Spirit. And the disciples were to be Christ's ambassadors, his representatives, who moved out into the world. This is the very purpose for which they were appointed, to represent Christ among the people of the world. 2 Corinthians 5:20 says, "Now then, we are ambassadors for Christ, as though God were pleading through us. We implore you, we beg you on Christ's behalf, be reconciled to God. Come back to God." The disciples were appointed to preach. And preach means to be a herald, an announcer. It means to proclaim, to publish, to put out. But preach also carries with it the idea of intense feelings, seriousness, importance, and authority. So much so that it must be listened to and heeded. The person who preaches is the herald of Jesus Christ,
yes.
the announcer of Jesus Christ. That is, the message that he preaches is the message of Christ, not the message of himself or someone else.
Yes.
The herald, the announcer, doesn't share his opinion and views. He proclaims the truth of Jesus Christ. Amen. And the disciples were to be the announcers, the messengers of Jesus Christ. Jesus had a message for the world, and they were to proclaim his message to the world. Amen. Luke chapter 9 verse 2 says, he sent them to preach the kingdom of God and to heal the sick. The disciples were appointed to receive power. Power to minister, power to heal sicknesses, and power to cast out demons. But this power wasn't dunamis power. It wasn't the supernatural power of God. It was a delegated power or authority. Because as a servant of God, you're not given the power of God to use as you will. You're given the authority to specifically minister by healing and casting out demons. As a servant of God, you pray and speak the word, and then God does the actual healing and casting out of the demon. Thus, as a servant of God, you're given authority to cast out the evil spirits that rule people's lives. And the disciples were given power and authority. They were given the power to heal and to cast out demons, and to prove that Christ was truly the Son of God. Luke chapter 10 verses 19 through 20 says, behold, I give you the authority to trample on serpents and scorpions and over all the power of the enemy, and nothing shall by any means hurt you. Nevertheless, do not rejoice in this, that the spirits are subject to you, but rather rejoice because your names are written in heaven. The apostles were given the same authority and power of Jesus because they were being sent in Jesus's name. Mm-hmm. They were proclaiming Jesus and his message to be true, and they were proving it by the power given to them. Verses 16 through 19 says, Simon, to whom he gave the name Peter, James, the son of Zebedee, and John, the brother of James, to whom he gave the names Boanerges, that is, sons of thunder, Andrew, Philip, Bartholomew, Matthew, Thomas, James, the son of Alphaeus, Thaddeus, Simon the Canaanite, and Judas Iscariot, who also betrayed him, and they went into a house. The disciples were men changed by Jesus, but it's critical to keep in mind that each man had to be willing to be changed. And of course, there was one that wasn't willing to be changed, Judas Iscariot. Jesus called them all, but only the ones willing to be changed were changed. Jesus calls choice men, and he has a great impact on their lives. Yes. Peter, a rough-cut fisherman, was called by Jesus, and he looked, acted, and spoke like any professional fisherman at the dock of a large lake or sea. And anyone who's been around a fisherman's dock or boat can picture Peter. Peter had many commendable strengths. He was self-sacrificing, giving up all he had, even his home and business, to follow Jesus. Peter was spiritual-minded. He was the first to really grasp who Jesus was. He was childlike and humble, often responding and leaping out to Jesus as a child does to a father. Peter was trusting, sometimes casting his whole being upon Jesus. Peter was tender-hearted and loving. He cared deeply for his Lord. Peter was courageous. He was the only disciple who defended Jesus against arrest. He was also one of the two disciples who followed Jesus through his trials and crucifixion, although he followed at a distance. Peter would have been judged a hard-working, industrious man by any society. But he also had some glaring weaknesses. He was prideful and presumptuous. He was arrogant, rude, and bold. Peter was a man who thought he knew best, and sometimes he lorded over others. He was domineering, and he acted arrogantly toward others. Peter was always depending on human wisdom and strength. He was depending on the arm of the flesh. Peter thought he knew what was best for Jesus, insisting that Jesus didn't have to die. Peter tried to prevent Jesus' arrest by drawing his sword and wounding one of the arresting party. Peter Peter rebuked Jesus, overstepping the limits of his rights. And when the crowd thronged Jesus, Jesus simply asked who had touched him. But Peter rebuked Jesus. Peter reprimanded Jesus for asking such a question, especially since there were so many people pressing in on him. Luke chapter 8 verse 45 says, "And Jesus said, who touched me? When all denied it, Peter and those with him said, Master, the multitudes throng and press you, and you say, who touched me?" Just imagine, Peter reprimanded Jesus. Peter, in a self-abasing pride, a demeaning pride, refused to let Jesus wash his feet. Peter was slow to learn and understand the truth. He was self-seeking. He was disbelieving, skeptical, suspicious, questioning, and uncertain. And he was overbearing, even to the point of instructing Jesus. Peter had a weak, cowardly trait. He was the only disciple who vocally denied Jesus. Remember, he denied Jesus three times. And so Peter had strengths and weaknesses. He was self-sacrificing, yet self-seeking. He was spiritual-minded, yet slow to learn spiritual truth. He was childlike and humble, yet presumptuous and prideful. He was trusting, yet disbelieving. He was tender-hearted and loving, yet overbearing. He was courageous, yet cowardly. But after Jesus' resurrection and after Pentecost, Peter was dramatically changed. Yeah. The presence of the living Lord in his life empowered him, and Peter was able to take charge of the frightened band of disciples and lead them to fearlessly proclaim the glorious news of the risen Savior.
Hallelujah.
2 Corinthians 5:17 says, "Therefore, if anyone is in Christ, he is a new creation. All things have passed away. Behold, all things have become new." If anyone is in Christ, you're a whole new creation. You're changed by Christ.
Amen.
And as a believer, as a true, genuine believer, you're not only changed from within, mm-hmm. you're a mysterious new creation in Christ. A whole new order of creative energy begins with Christ. There's a new covenant, a new perspective, a new body, a new church, and we're the church, the body of Christ, that's being renewed. Why? Because we're the choice, ordinary people called by God. So sit up and take notice, because the old worn out ways are being replaced with the new. And this isn't a superficial change that will be quickly superseded by some other novelty. This is an entirely new order, because you are now under Christ's authority. You're that choice, ordinary person that surrendered to Jesus. You've allowed Jesus to change your heart, your life, and this requires a new way of looking at all people and all creation. And prayerfully, your life reflects this new perspective.
Yeah.
Then there was James and John, and they were called by Jesus, and these two men were brothers. But there were two disciples named James. The first James mentioned in this passage, the brother of John, was the son of Zebedee. And he, along with Peter and his brother John, formed the inner circle around the Lord. And this James is never mentioned apart from John. And he was killed with the sword by Herod. The second James, the lesser James, was the son of Alphaeus. And he was called the lesser James because he was shorter than the other James. And so the first James and John were the sons of Zebedee, a prosperous fisherman who was a man of high social position. And apparently he was well acquainted with the high priest in his household, probably providing fish for the palace. Their mother was Salome, who was thought by many to be the sister of Mary, the mother of Jesus. But James and John were men with stormy tempers, so much so that Jesus called them Boanerges, which means sons of thunder. And their tempers are seen when they ask Jesus to destroy a Samaritan village with fire for rejecting him. Luke chapter 9 verse 54 says, "And when the disciples came, disciples James and John saw this, they said, "Lord, do you want us to command fire to come down from heaven and consume them just as Elijah did?" Those two brothers were also gripped by worldly ambition, wanting the highest offices in the coming kingdom of Jesus. But Jesus dramatically changed these two men. Jesus changed their stormy temper into a burning zeal and ambition for God. Amen. And they became two of the greatest witnesses for God the world has ever known. James became the first of the 12 to be martyred. And John was the longest living disciple, becoming one of the greatest literary giants of all times. Andrew was called by Jesus, and Andrew was apparently the first disciple of our Lord. He had been a disciple of John the Baptist that was longing for a messianic hope. However, when John pointed out that Jesus was the Messiah, Andrew requested an interview with Jesus. And from that point on, he was convinced that Jesus was the true Messiah, and Jesus granted him a very special friendship. Jesus met Andrew's craving for the messianic hope and enlarged his gifts of love and caring. Thus, Andrew was always helping people. Tradition said that Andrew preached in Jerusalem and was crucified for preaching against idolatry, and that he was hung on the cross in the shape of an X because he didn't want to be hung like Jesus in the shape of a cross. Philip was called by Jesus. Philip didn't seek Jesus. Jesus sought Philip. Amen. John chapter 1 verse 43 says, "The following day Jesus wanted to go to Galilee, and he found Philip, and he said to him, 'Follow me.'" This indicates that Philip was slow in responding and believing, so much so that he almost missed the opportunity to become an apostle of Jesus. In fact, being slow to respond and fearing to act seems to be the major weaknesses of Philip. Philip actually missed the opportunity to demonstrate great faith when Jesus tested his faith in feeding the multitude. He was also slow in responding when some Greeks wanted to interview Jesus. John chapter 12, verses 21 through 22 says, "Then they came to Philip, who was from Bethsaida of Galilee, and asked him, saying, 'Sir, we wish to see Jesus.' Philip came and told Andrew, and in turn, Andrew and Philip told Jesus." Again, Philip was slow in understanding who Jesus was. His faith and willingness to act were in constant need of being stirred and strengthened. But Jesus changed Philip, making him a man of strong faith. And this is seen in that he stood fast and fearless, even in the face of martyrdom. Tradition tells us that he died as a martyr at Hierapolis, which was a sacred city of the early church. Jesus called Bartholomew, and Bartholomew is thought to be the same person as Nathanael, but little is known about this disciple other than what's given by John, and yet Jesus impacted his life. Jesus called Matthew, and Matthew was a tax collector. He was an outcast of society. He was a traitor to the Jewish people, and he felt the alienation and rejection ever so deeply. Yet Jesus took Matthew and changed his life, meeting every need of his heart. Amen. Thomas, Didymus, meaning the twin, was called by Jesus. Thomas was a man of courage and loyalty, and this is seen in his suggestion that the disciples follow Jesus even if it meant death. John chapter 11 verse 16 says, "Then Thomas, who is called the twin, said to his fellow disciples, 'Let us also go that we may die with him.'" But Thomas was also a skeptic, a pessimist, a doubter. He was slow to understand Jesus' messiahship, and he rejected the testimony of others that Jesus had actually risen from the dead. But the resurrection of Jesus changed Thomas, and it changed him completely. And Thomas has given the world one of the strongest testimonies possible. John chapter 20 verse 28 says, "And Thomas answered and said to him, 'My Lord and my God.'" Thomas Thomas testified of Jesus, and tradition says that Thomas went to Parthia, India, carrying the gospel to that great continent. And Thomas was said to have died a martyr's death. James, the son of Alphaeus, was called by Jesus, but little is known about this second James. We know that his father was Alphaeus, and his mother was one of the women who stood by the cross and visited the tomb of Jesus, and that he had a brother named Joses, who was also a follower of Jesus. And it's interesting to note that Matthew's father was also named Alphaeus. Thus, it's possible that James and Matthew were brothers. And tradition says that James was a tax collector, just like Matthew. And if this is true, then it would give weight to their being brothers. The point is this: James was willing to be changed by Jesus. Mm-hmm. He was willing to become a true disciple of the Lord. And he didn't forsake the disciples after the crucifixion. He stayed right there with them. Therefore, he was present when Jesus appeared to the disciples after his resurrection and began transforming. Thaddeus was called by Jesus, and Thaddeus is also called Judas, son of James, but little is known about him except his name means breast, or one that praises, or man of heart. The fact that Matthew and Mark called him by the name Thaddeus, the man of heart, reveals that he was a man with a big heart, and the presence of the living Lord in his heart and life could only enlarge such a heart. Amen. Simon the Canaanite, or Simon the Zealot, was called by Jesus, mm-hmm. and Simon was a member of the fanatical Jewish party known as the Zealots, who believed that God alone was to be the ruler and Lord of the Jewish nation. And they hated and bitterly opposed all foreign Roman domination. They preached and led revolutionary uprisings against the government when they could be formed. Wow. And the power of Jesus to change a man's heart is seen in Simon the Zealot. Simon's fanatical devotion turned him into a zealot for Jesus, and he never changed the description of his fanatical nature. Even after his conversion and call, he still wanted to be known for his zeal. He still wanted to be known as Simon the Zealot, the one who was totally devoted to Jesus Christ, the true Messiah. And then there was Judas Iscariot, the one who betrayed Jesus, and he too was called by Jesus. But Judas wasn't willing to have his heart and life changed by Jesus. Jesus impacted the lives of all the disciples except one, Judas Iscariot. And yet all of these men were choice men called by Jesus, men that were appointed by Jesus to be with him, to be sent forth, to preach, and to receive authority. These men were called by Jesus, appointed by Jesus, but most importantly, these men were changed by Jesus. Hallelujah. Jesus called choice, ordinary men to be his disciples, men with a mixture of backgrounds and personalities. And today, God calls choice, ordinary people together to build his church, to teach salvation's message, and to serve others out of love. Alone, we may feel unqualified to serve Christ effectively, but God doesn't call the qualified. He qualifies the called. And together, we make up a group strong enough to serve God in any way. You just need to ask God for patience to accept the diversity of people in your church, and then to build on the variety of strengths represented in your group. Remember, we are choice, ordinary people called by God. We're on God's team, and we're anything but perfect, but God knew this when he called us. The 12 disciples were different people that were called together for a common purpose. We could say that these men were blue collar and white collar. We could say that they were strongly muscular and desk jockey thin. We could say that these men were passionate and thoughtful, transparently simple and cunningly sophisticated. We could say that they were wealthy and dirt poor. But from this unlikely group came a message that changed the world. Will you help that change continue? Whatever your strengths are, and no matter what your weaknesses are, there's a place for you.
Yeah.
We're choice, ordinary people, mm-hmm. called by God and changed by God. And on God's team, no two people part their hair the same way.
Right.
And yet, through cooperation, acceptance, and love, our human differences can contribute to an effective witness for Christ. Just remember, Jesus doesn't just call anyone. Jesus calls choice people, people with hearts that are ripe and ready to be melted and molded. But not only that, he calls and appoints us, he anoints us, and then he changes us. Very simply, Jesus impacts the lives of those he calls. He impacts the lives of choice, ordinary people. He impacts the lives of those who accept his call. Amen?
Amen. Amen.
Hallelujah.
Thank you, Lord. Thank you.